20-minute slot out of
1 out of 3, but now it's significantly longer. So what you should have, so people who manage to read the instructions for the meetup will have brought their laptops and had VirtualBox installed. And there's a USB key with a VirtualBox appliance, and the presentations folder on it. Is not essential to use it, but it may make a lot more sense if you do have it. On there, this is basically part of a much larger repo, which has got a whole bunch of deep learning resources on it. And the reason that the VirtualBox appliance is a gigabyte is because it includes data, it includes pre-trained models. I'm just going to do one of these models and but probably go through it in some detail just because we have some time. For anyone who has already copied the VirtualBox appliance, what you can do is if you start VirtualBox and do import appliance, the whole thing should start running and offer the opportunity to do Jupyter, all in Mongo. Okay, so the talk today is extracting names using RNNs, and I will very quickly introduce myself and then tell you roughly what's going to happen. So I've been doing machine learning kind of startups, kind of finance, for a long time. I've moved from New York City to Singapore in 2013. 2014, I just read papers and wrote code. Since 2015, I've been doing a natural language processing project for a local company here in Singapore and writing a paper or two. So here's a quick overview of what we're talking about. NLP here is natural language processing. I will have one slide on why you might want to do this. Then we'll launch into neural networks. First, the very basics, just in case you don't know what's going on for neural networks. And then talk about word embeddings and recurrent neural networks, which are kind of the meat of the talk. And then the workshop, which is where, if you have a laptop, you'll be able to follow along and see how it works. We'll be implementing something I call uppercase NER, which is kind of an interesting project to learn using an RNN. Then I might talk about some kind of more exotic examples briefly. So, natural language processing. This is the one slide if you need to know why bother. Basically, it would be nice to be able to work with text as an input. While a lot of the deep learning stuff is to do with visual images or self-driving cars or gameplay, the vast majority of people working on floors in Singapore is working with text. Text is kind of like the de facto human-optimized best way of transmitting information. Very rarely do you try and draw pictures of what you would describe. Basically, everything's text. If we can do a good job with this, we have conquered a huge amount of white-collar busy work. So there's some text analysis you might want to do, finding out what people want for, you know, with their customer requests. You might want to do translation, particularly in this kind of region. You may want to extract knowledge. So the particular topic which I'm involved in for the local company is we read PDFs, where a PDF is just basically text at XY coordinates on each page. And from that, we want to extract who is in the document, who works where, which company owns which other company, who went to which university, when, and essentially take that from PDF annual report and produce a nice structured database of the output. So this is knowledge extraction. And that's all I'm going to say about natural language processing. If you want to do it, you probably know already. So I will quickly digress into basic neural networks, just so that we're all on the same page. And for the people who just came in, if you have laptops, you're going to want to have one of these USB keys. Looking at the USB keys won't help you. You need to pick up a USB key to install it on your laptop. Take some back.
Thank you.
So basically, Neural networks, the basic building blocks of these things are not at all magical. We take simple mathematical units and we combine them repeatedly to compute complex functions. So here's the typical example of a single neuron. Basically, at the bottom, we have the inputs, which we call x1, x2, x3. At the top, we have our output, which we call y by convention. And in the middle, what we're doing is we take a weighted sum of the various inputs, and we then apply a nonlinearity. So this is in all of this deep learning stuff, this is the very basic unit, but this is replicated many millions of times. So here's a very simple diagram of how to make this a bit more complex. Again, we've got three inputs at the bottom, but instead of just having a direct connection between the input and the output via this one cell, we compute interim values. Now these interim values, we've got in the first hidden layer here, hidden one, we've got five different interim values. And the point of these is that this would enable, if we were very lucky, when we train this thing, we're going to actually learn to represent the data in some more sophisticated way. And back in the 90s, this was where all the mystique was, because people couldn't really train these very well. And this caused one of the AI winters. What has happened since the mid-2000s is that people have worked out how to make this deeper, how to make the training work, and they now find it's kind of embarrassingly easy to make work. So the way you train this is called, for our purposes, is going to be supervised learning. Basically, we're going to pick a training case. So we've got a particular set of inputs and a particular target value that we want to return. So it may be that the inputs will be the values of pixels of a picture, and the output is, this is a cat. The alternative would be, this is a dog, say. So you basically pick an input picture. So I want this to say it's a cat, and then I say, well, what does the network say? So I evaluate the output for these inputs. And then I modify all the weights in this network so that the output y is closer to saying this is a cat. Now, the beauty of this is that we haven't really specified what it means to be a cat. Basically, if we have sufficient data and sufficient time, and we jiggle the weights just right in this modify word here, if we jiggle the weights just right, this thing will start to say cat more often when there's a cat in the picture. And that's at least the big hope. So, now, one of the key concepts here is a thing called backpropagation. Basically, how do we jiggle these weights, or how do we modify these weights? Basically, if the weight is connected to an output, it's pretty easy. It's easy to assign blame to why the weight is giving us the wrong idea or not. But otherwise, what you need to do is start propagating the blame of why it's getting it wrong, or congratulation messages for why it's getting it right, back through the network, which is why it's called backpropagation. The errors backpropagate through the network. So basically, people have been doing this for a long time, since the 80s at least. The trick, though, is that now it works. So let's have a quick look at what's going on inside. First, we'll have a quick look at the input features, then what each neuron is learning, and how the training converges. So if everyone's got their laptop open, there will be a thing which is, if you go in there, you should have a TensorFlow example. Or if you're connected to Microsoft Online, you could have a look at TensorFlow Playground. If you search for TensorFlow Playground, you'll get a picture somewhat like this. Now, does anyone have a laptop and not understand what's going on? Because I'm just going to have a quick play with this. So this is a beautiful thing from Google. Google has got a deep learning library called TensorFlow, but this is kind of a JavaScript-y front end. It's all in JavaScript, so I'm not sure even it has proper TensorFlow embedded. What we have here is on the left-hand side, so basically there's the picture that we had before, is rotated this way. On the left-hand side, we've got the various features which it's trying to learn, or trying to learn from. And then we have some layers, and then we have an output. Now, what we're trying to learn here is, if you look at the top over here, basically there's a little scatter of, I'm going to call them orange and blue, I'm probably wrong, a little scatter of a target shape. And the idea here is, can we use the features, which is x1, which is just a gradation this way, and x2, which is a gradation this way, to learn how to classify on the right-hand side whether it should be a blue area or an orange area. Forgive my color blindness. So the idea here is, if I press the big go button, it will use these two inputs to create these midway internal features, and then use those to gather them together to make something. So basically, if we do this, so you can see over on this side, you'll see that this is the training error. Basically, as these weights for these internal things have moved around, it has now actually constructed an internal representation which has managed to classify the two areas, one from the other. If we go for something like this, so this is up in this corner we have essentially quadrants. If we make it do this, what happens is it's got a tough time. Okay. So you can see that basically, very quickly, by manipulating these weights, we can make it so it's learnt some internal representation. And the interesting thing here is, even though its inputs are just vertical and horizontal, it's actually tried to learn this shape by learning some diagonals. So it's managed to construct this shape out of various pieces of diagonal. Even though I didn't tell it what a good internal representation would be, it's figured out on its own. Now, if you want, you can play around with this. We can add some more things. We can add another hidden layer. We can do something tricky. And so here with a whole bunch of different things, which you could, let's see whether this. So I know for a fact this is going to struggle. So gradually, it's going to. Ooh, okay. So you can see that out of just a few internal units here, you can start to construct something, which fits better. It is not clear that it actually understands what the image is about, or why it's doing what it is, but it's trying to score as many points as possible on some kind of loss function. Now, if we start this again, you'll also find that there will be sometimes it doesn't figure it out. No, it's going to figure something out. So this is also a stochastic process. There's no particular reason to be sure it's going to converge. There is mathematics around this, but it peters out very quickly to have a go. Having a go with these things is the reason why people hopefully have brought laptops with them, because actually seeing this works is the proof that most people is as good a proof as you'll get mathematically. Okay. Somewhere in here. Okay, sorry. Okay, so this is, in a sense, this is the story for neural networks for images. Basically, if you have a bunch of features as your input in some kind of fixed array, and you have classes that you want to find. There are other tricks called, there's convolutions, you can have them deeper networks. But basically, this is all you need to know to make neural networks work in some sense. You can map images to classes, you can do a great many interesting things. The problem when it comes to text is text isn't the same shape as a picture. When you have a sentence, let's have a sentence which is the cat sat on the mat, okay. How do you represent as a feature the word cat? So this is one basic problem, is that to represent this so you can then manipulate it is in kind of the entirely wrong format. Another thing is that the sentences aren't in fixed formats at all. How long is a sentence? We want to be able to, we don't want to impose like a, here's a predetermined maximum length of a sentence. I want to be able to read sentences of any length. So the question is, how do we parse through stuff which is words, which we don't yet know how to encode, and let me assure you that having just pictures of the word is the wrong way to do it. How do we go from essentially the sense of words as written into something that which can be manipulated by these neural networks, and how can we do that for something of indeterminate length? So this is, in a way, I was showing you the basic neural networks just to get a clear understanding of how it would be mapping from features to output, and how we'd use the errors in the output to kind of feedback by map propagation. So now let's talk about, in particular, how to set this up for natural language. So when it comes to handling words, English as a language, as a base case, would say have 100,000 words. Typically, vocabulary would be more than this, but you can see that 100,000 words would be a very is a very inadequate representation. Because imagine the very first word. How do we identify this word? Maybe you have a word which is what's called a one-hot encoding. Basically, it's a one where it is the word, and a zero if it's not the word. So the would be one, and then all the zeros. And then a might be zero, one, and then all zeros. So this is a one-hot encoding. This is a terrible encoding because it has no idea of the commonality of words. It's 100,000 features for every word location. This is not the right way to do it. It does seem wasteful. But wouldn't it be nice if we could actually learn about how words are related to each other from an actual corpus, where a corpus is just a huge quantity of data? So this is one of the things which people have been trying to play around with since the 90s. They made it much too complicated in the 2000s. And in about 2010, this thing called Word2Vec came along, and suddenly everything made a lot of sense, and it became stunningly easy to do this kind of thing. So word embedding, which is the major advance here, they're basically Word2Vec is one nice implementation. There's another one which I kind of like myself called Glove. The basic idea is for every word, you'll have a 300-dimensional vector. Now this, where do you get these numbers from? Well, you get the numbers by reading text. And you don't actually know a priori how the words relate to each other. You just put in large amounts of text. So what you do with this text, suppose a typical training set would be Wikipedia, just for starters, okay? So you take Wikipedia and you run a window across the entire Wikipedia, which is, say, 10 words long. And what I want, and my setup for this, is I would like my vector so that if I take two words and multiply their vectors together, the number I get as a result will tell me how likely the words are to be in the same window within Wikipedia. So the cat will co-occur quite often, but the trampoline, I don't know, that's a bad example. Trampoline cat will not occur very, very often, right? Trampoline vacuum cat, these three words will not occur very often at all. So just by reading the text, I can actually start to build a picture of how likely words are to appear together. And the trick here is, and this is what people find, is that if you slide this window across the text, and you start everything off with a random vector, and you nudge them so that they start to words that occur next to each other start to have a higher likelihood of being next to each other. What happens is the entire vector space organizes itself so that this just works. So I'm not sure where you can see this. Basically, this is saying let's take a 100 dimensional vector. We take it, we train it over a window of words, and I'm not sure, it's probably difficult to see. Basically, if I'm looking for the word France, which is word number 454, the most similar ones to the word France will be Austria, Belgium, Germany, Italy, Greece, Sweden, Norway. So this is purely by reading Wikipedia. I've given it no actual knowledge of the English language. I haven't told it about countries, but it is on its own recognized. And the reason why I may have done this is if the word France will often have the words country of France, okay. But the word country will co-occur equally well with each of these other ones, or France has a democracy. All these ancillary words will boost all the other countries in exactly the same way as France, so they tend to occupy the same space. Jesus is probably a bit controversial. Xbox, equally. Reddish, okay, so reddish, it's just by reading Wikipedia, it says reddish, greenish, bluish, pinkish, purplish, brownish. So not only has it got the colors, but it's got the parts of speech or the usefulness in speech, or scratched, nailed, smashed, punched, popped, crimped, scraped, or megabits, octets, megabytes per second, bits per second, board, carats. So you can see that in these columns, it's just picked up some regularities in the English language just by reading text without any preconception about what English. So if you do the same with Spanish, same thing happens. Do the same with Japanese, Chinese, same thing happens, in that similar concepts will start to clump together. You can actually form maps between these languages. Interesting. Here's another freebie that you get out of this. And this is the classic. This is the classic one. So if you look at the direction between the vector for man and the vector for woman, the difference between them, you can say, well, this is kind of gender. If you say, well, what's the difference between king and queen? The crazy thing is that you get vectors in the same direction. So equally, if you look at the difference between king, man to king, and woman to what, the what would be queen here. So it's actually, as well as picking up these semantic analogies, it also picks up a geometric interpretation. So here's another one. If the difference between walking and walked is the same as swimming and swam. So here it's picked up a kind of cunning grammatical feature of English out of no preconceptions. Similarly, on this side, if you look at the cluster of countries, and here you'll find, on the other side, you'll find in this big 300-dimensional space, or 100-dimensional space, here's all the capital cities, you can actually find that the direction between all the countries and their corresponding capital cities lines up much better than you'd expect. And so it's actually picked up this just because words occurring together kind of indicate something. Okay, so that's word embedding. And we can have a look at that, because there's a whole word embedding embedded in the virtual appliance. Networks on sequences, okay. The problem with sentences is you've got a variable length input. So you've got all of these words, and it's not like a picture where you have a field of view. The number of words could be any length. So how do you apply a single network to this input? So the trick here is basically you imagine that the words coming in sequentially, and you process each time step separately with the same network. But when you process something, you record your internal state. So after you've seen a word, you update kind of like an internal memory cell, and then you look at the next word. So the next word is informed both by the word you see and what you've remembered. You then move along. So gradually you're building a more and more complex internal state as you move along the sentence. Now the trick is at the end of the sentence or wherever it is, you actually get the correct answer, your classification or whatever. And the question is, how do we then backpropagate errors? Basically all we've done is we've had this one network and we've rolled it, the state, from one place to the next, to the next, to the next. So the weights affecting this at every stage, we can identify. If we have a clever unrolling machine, which is what one of these frameworks will do for us, it will allow us to backpropagate errors through any number of crazy network architectures. So let's just say this again. So basically for a recurrent neural network, and this is why it's called recurrent, because you're applying itself to itself kind of thing. You take a network and you apply it iteratively. You have an internal state which you can carry forward stepwise, and everything is still differentiable. And because it's differentiable, we can then assign blame from any errors it makes back to every single weight through the whole of his experience. Equally, we can assign blame to the embedding as well if we wanted to. But so here's a basic RNN. And so people start to draw little diagrams. So basically, this is the concept. You have an input, some stuff which feeds back on itself, and here's your output. Or you can consider them as unrolling this through time. So this will be the first word in the sentence. So this would be the cat sat, full stop, okay? When you use the word the, it goes in, gets processed however, gives us some output, and it will be then whatever, it also generates something which is useful to the next word, and useful to the next word, and useful to the next word. And at the end of the day, we then use whatever this is to say, okay, how are we going to reward everything which went before us? Now this is the simple version, in that basically we've still just got an input, some multiplication, and a delay, and an output. So because every node knows the history and all the weights are basically the same network has been used again and again, you can think of the actual depth of the network as being through time rather than through deep. Okay, so this is the same diagram. Basically, here's your input, here's a little plus and a little non-linearity, here's your next state, rolling along and along. Now, it gets a bit more complicated because one of the problems with this basic RNN, is that if you have a gradient problem, so if you have a mistake coming out at the end of the chain, and we need to start rolling back these errors over time, every little gradient along the way gives us an opportunity for getting it wronger and wronger. And what tends to happen is in this basic RNN is that the gradients explode or the gradients vanish. And so if you've got a very long sentence, you'll never train the word the at the beginning of the sentence, or assuming this is the first input word. Because basically this is kind of an unbounded problem, it's these gradients like build up and up and up and multiply on each other. So if you have a gradient, if you have some variable A here, by the time you've applied itself to itself, to itself, to itself, you've got A to the 20 at the end of the sentence, it's very difficult to pass back any gradient information. So what people do is they have a thing called, they have gating mechanisms. And basically, they start to split, here's your input. And instead of just applying this to the output, I will start to have a thing which either forgets or remembers or clears, so which enables the state to be kind of stored raw. So rather than being multiplied by a number every time, basically it gets either set or reset. Basically, people do this and they say, well, look, it can be differentiated. And as soon as it can be differentiated, it can learn. Therefore, we're going to use this. And what people find is this idea of having forgetting or remembering is really effective, and it prevents this, because the same state can be brought verbatim from one thing, one step to the next. If the gate thing says yes, it will be brought verbatim. Because it's verbatim, you have no gradient loss. There's no blow-ups going on. So people do this. Okay, this works. This would be this is a one-liner in your framework. The next thing people do is a thing called LSTM units. There's an updating term. There's an input gate, output gate. There's a forget gate. Da, 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 da. All of this is a whole bunch of matrix manipulation with a somewhat crazy set of non-linearities, and it will be implemented in one line in one of these frameworks. If anyone says, oh yes, we're using LSTMs, it's shorthand for this, but basically this is become a detail which kind of just works. Piled higher and deeper. Also PhD, so. As well as the LSTMs, you can also, extending out time-wise, you can then pile them on top of each other. So not only is the RNN producing state for itself, it can produce state for the next layer of higher and higher level representations. So you can run these. So this enables it to get very sophisticated. On the other hand, the sophistication is not really in the model, it's in the fact that you need a GPU. So you have your GPU or a cluster, and you pile the data through it, and you see whether it learns. Basically, if you have something really sophisticated, you'll start off with something simple, and you'll pile on more and more until something learns. Once something learns, then you can start to dial it back a bit. What people also do is they'll run them forwards and backwards. So one of the things, if I've got a sentence and I'm only going forwards, I can never kind of anticipate the verb at the end, for instance, if it's German. Whereas if I'm running back both forwards and backwards, I can carry sense in both directions. People also play games with having a trees-like structure. Anyway, the key point here is everything is still differentiable. Because it can be differentiated, so we can blame any output on the weights which caused it. And because of that, I can then fiddle every little weight and train this thing. Because it can be trained, because it's differentiable, it can be trained. Because it can be trained, it can learn to do NLP, which is kind of surprising. Are there any questions?
Is there any good way we can vectorize a sentence?
Yes. So what I'll do is I'll show you, and you'll have it on your thing. So the vectorizing the sentence is this word embedding. So this is kind of step one of all of the natural language work, is to come up with a word embedding, which every word will then come up with a bunch of numbers, which is the input. So the input that the word the will be well, the word the is not a very good word kind of thing, but it will have a series of numbers which is the representation for the. The cat is a much more defined place in space, because cat is near lion, it's a fair distance from dog, but it's very far from trampoline. Okay, so we can use the word the numbers for cat, and great, as you go along the sentence, you'll have a whole bunch of numbers, and we can then roll this RNN along that. So the words vanish almost immediately into the embedding. Does that make sense?
Can this be applied to non-Latin languages like Chinese, for example?
So the issue with Chinese, so the answer is yes. I mean, the issue with Chinese is you have your alphabet's very large. On the other hand, from my understanding, the actual vocabulary is kind of small in terms of hundreds of thousands. It's not. English is an extremely rich language, and it also has lots and lots of overlapping meanings. Chinese has like a segmentation problem. So not only do you have symbols, you have pairs of symbols or a combination of them. But absolutely, people do this all day long. The grammar is also somewhat simplified in Chinese, from what I understand.
You said it's kind of surprising. Can you elaborate about why the differential property is kind of surprising for the modifier?
So it's not surprising that it's differentiable. Given that these units are set up as just being linear combinations of things, with the non-linearities are even not particularly well differentiable. But in fact, they're differentiable only at a few places, and you almost never hit them. So you have a huge function which is differentiable. It is surprising that that can actually learn language, that it's sufficient space that just by manipulating parameters over this whole space, that this thing will actually capture some sense of the language.
Is that Bayesian analysis.
Bayes, okay. So there is a kind of a branch of neural. So the Bayesian guys have proper mathematics, and that's beautiful, and they do the right thing. The problem is that they also have issues with making this stuff work, whereas the neural net guys will turn up and blithely just make it work. There's a whole bunch of serious work with Bayesian stuff, and there are people who are trying to marry the two together to say, well, look, really this network is doing something which is pretty Bayesian. But the problem that the Bayesian guys have is that the neural network guys come and trample all over them with the next crazy innovation.
Is that like some brute force?
Brute force is a very good word for it, yes. But the Bayesians, in a way, is kind of an idealized, like it's a spherical cow kind of thing. And it's brilliant and can give you really beautifully correct answers. But the thing is that the neural network guys want results. And which is sad, sorry.
Yeah, this vanishing gradient is a numerical problem, essentially. It's more than that.
It is a numerical problem in as much as that's where it finally gets you. I mean, you will get lost in numerical noise.
Just because you have a lot of small numbers and you can't propagate the error, right? But if you have a big enough, like, big float, big double, is it...
So you're saying if you had enough precision, it wouldn't be a problem. Okay. this is one of the things which held up the field a lot in like the 90s, in that people would have these matrices, essentially. They'd set up their networks with small random values. And the problem is, if all your weights are small and random, if you think about the essential sizing that your input gets resized to, the whole thing just gets smaller. It's much better to have a matrix which is about an expansion factor of one, because then everything kind of takes care of itself. And so that this kind of is not a condition number, but it's kind of like the expansion factor of this matrix. If you can make it about one, then you don't get this vanishing problem, whatever. This is one of the key things. People are always wondering, well, why have all my weights vanished to zero? And once they realize you should set them all to be something like 1 over root n, that's a much better number to make your matrix about well-behaved. Now, what people are doing now in order to kind of force that is that they will take an input vector and they will normalize it so it's about the right kind of scale. And they will do that at multiple levels through the thing so that the neural network has no opportunity to get into this mess. So this kind of renormalization, batch normalization, is another trick that people do to avoid getting trapped. So while the numerical precision thing is what gets you in the end, if you can sidestep that entirely, you're in a much, much happier place. Okay, let me press on. So now we're gonna get, let me just have a quick check. Okay, let me talk, so this is basically the intro to what's on your laptops now, and we can have a quick go through. Basically, the motivation here is named entity recognition, NER. The motivation here is, part of my job was to build a quality NLP system for a Singapore startup. An essential component of doing NLP is to have good named entity recognition. There are various licensing problems which prevent you from using existing NLP systems, and I didn't want to use any expensive data. And so this is kind of a background as to why someone might care about this. This is a quick example of what NER does. Basically, the first sentence is, soon after his graduation, Jim Soon became managing director of Lam Soon. So there are various problems with the sentence. Obviously, we want to identify Jim Soon as a person, as an entity, and Lam Soon as the organization that he works for. And to know the difference, because I don't know that Lam Soon isn't a person, the fact that managing director has capital letters means I can't really rely on the capital letters. The first word, Soon, is just naughty. And so you can see that this problem, this sentence is not so easy. You need to understand a bit about people become managing directors. You are a managing director of a thing, or an organization, not a person. Anyway, if you can understand more about English, then you can pick this out. So the question here is, can we train a recurrent neural network to do NER? And the way we would do this is we would create a word embedding, we'd get some kind of annotated data set, and then we'd train the RNN on the data set. But, and this is particular, it's partly to do with the fact I've handed something out, it's very expensive to have a human annotated corpus, in that we actually want to train on 1 billion words. And in order to have a properly annotated 1 billion word corpus, I need someone to go through it, marking out where all the names are in 1 billion words. This would take longer than I have here. So what the trick I'm gonna use, and also where people have spent the time, is expensive data, and definitely something I can't hand out. So the trick here is I'm gonna take Wikipedia, and I'm using NLTK, which is the Python natural language toolkit, and I'm gonna annotate Wikipedia using this software tool. So it's going to point out where all the noun phrases are. I'm then going to train the RNN on this machine annotated text to see whether it can learn what NLTK can do. So NLTK has been, people have honed this over years, linguists have looked at this. I'm going to abandon all of that knowledge and just learn what it tells me. And then I'm going to see how it is, see how it performs. But the twist I'm going to make, though, to make it interesting, is in some sense, I'm only going to let the RNN have lowercase text. So NLTK, and we'll see this, loves to have capital letters when it's doing this NR task. Okay, the problem comes is in a PDF, it may be that someone's name appears in a title which is all capital letters, and NLTK will not give you any good information. But if I can make the RNN learn how to do NR from caseless text, then that's a win. So that's the thing. So for anyone who has a computer with the thing open, there's a thing called, can anyone find the Jupyter notebook thing? If you go in, has anyone got this? Has anyone not got this? Basically, you'll see here, if you go into the VirtualBox Jupyter examples, there's a thing called Deep Learning OVA, which you can launch. When you import that appliance, it will start off an entire Fedora machine. That Fedora machine has TensorFlow and Theano and Jupyter and word embeddings and Inception 3 and all sorts of nice stuff already there, ready to run for you. So there's also a password. If you click on this, there will be a password. So this is running on port 8080. The password is password. It's not secure. And I will do something similar. So excuse me for a moment. So this is the virtual machine which is in there. It's fully configured, Fedora 25, running Python 3. And that should be running. Let me just get a window. Where's it gone? So on here, there is a number 9 RNN tagger. So there's a whole bunch of stuff in here, which is MNIST, there's Google on Net, there's reinforcement learning, which is kind of cool, anomalies, some nice stuff. Okay. So what I'm going to do, so I'm conscious of the time. Where's the man with the time? He's run away. Okay, so what I'm going to do, I think I'm going to spend about 20 minutes going through this in some detail. What hopefully you can see some stuff. Basically, we're going to import a whole bunch of good stuff. Theano here is a framework with a lasagna, which is a kind of a layer thing. Is everyone okay? And basically, I'm going to import NLTK. I'm going to use a sentence splitter. Okay. So what we have here, this is number 4, is you can see that it's taken a sentence this is Mr. Smith's tokenized text, and split it into these tokens. So this is kind of an essential part. Okay, so what have you got? Have you started VirtualBox? Okay, you don't have to log into VirtualBox at all. If you go into a browser and go to localhost colon 8080, it should say password. And in that box, you type in the word password. And enter, and it should give you a... Has anyone got it working who can show him? Yes? Find someone. No, it's okay. It should. So, okay, let's keep pressing along. So, the corpus we've got here is the first 100,000 words of Wikipedia. And this corpus sentence tokens is a thing which you'll just pull off in a kind of a Python yield way, it's a generator way, just gives me more and more sentences. So here's a sentence, here's another one. So that you can just see that this is pulling stuff out of Wikipedia as much as I want, basically, an endless supply of Wikipedia. And this is what NLTK will say for this. So, okay, it has pulled out. No. These are the tokens which it can produce. So if we just, let's see what part of speech analysis on this sample text looks like. So you can see that this number 13, basically, this is just NLTK saying what part of speech everything in this sentence is. So this is something which comes out of the box with Python, which is nice. Now what I'm going to do here is I only care about nouns. For ner, I only care about nouns. And what I'll do now is do a glove embedding. So there is a nice package called glove, which does glove embeddings for you. So basically this, when you import glove, you can give it these lowercase sentences and then just fit this thing. So this is creating the co-occurrence matrix, which is basically which words occur with each other words for the first 100,000 words in Wikipedia. Okay, so it says, and now let's create the word embedding. Now this takes a little while, and you'll see how time consuming it can be. So this is going to take like 30 seconds. On the other hand, a good word embedding takes a lot longer than 30 seconds. So you'll see. So each time it's going through, I think it's using all of my cores. It's going through a bunch of epochs. It's going to do 20. So. Now, it may seem like it's taking a long time, but the reality is we're trying to learn the English language right now. So it shouldn't be underestimated, the difficulty of what it's trying to do here. Unfortunately, if you give a 5-year-old, or if you give a 0-year-old 2 minutes to learn English, they don't do a very good job. So there we have a 50-dimensional word embedding, and So unfortunately, this is not so good. So basically, I have a little function here, which word embedding, most similar to the word king, is story, Henry. Henry is possible, okay, band and house, not so good. Let's have another, most similar to the word road, radar. Channel and route aren't so bad. So this is just basically, in these 30 seconds, by looking at 100,000 words of Wikipedia, it's learnt something, not very convincing, about the English language, but it has learnt something. There's other helper functions, and this is where, this is basically the analogy. So it takes the vector for Paris, subtracts France, and adds the one for Italy. And my guess is I want the word Rome, but I don't. So Moscow, Paris, Connecticut, Berlin. It's got the idea that it wants cities and stuff, but it hasn't got a very good idea. So the problem is embedding is poor. Fortunately, there is a pre-baked one, basically, which is the, this uses quite a large corpus trained for quite a while. So now if we now look at this, so the from if you work at this a lot harder, you can have most similar words to road or bridge, highway, route, and lane, which is pretty good. This is now saying Rome, Italy, Milan, Turin, Venice, which is quite good. There's a whole bunch of other like examples. So this is the man, woman, king, queen thing. Queen, daughter, prince, and throne are up there. So this is showing that there is a this word embedding stuff works. You can play with it. It's a it's right there. Training this for 30 seconds doesn't do a whole lot of good. You can download pre-trained glove embeddings, pre-trained word-to-vec embeddings, and have a way with it. So what I'll do now is I'll kind of quickly go through this part of speech tagger, mainly to demonstrate that it can be done here. Basically, I have some helper functions to produce batches of sentences, and I'm going to have a, this function here will produce a like the NLT version of NER for a given sentences. And basically this is the embeddings for this sentence. Okay. So in here, in this thing, this is the main meat of the network. Basically this is defining some layers as inputs. And here is a forward RNN, which is a GRU layer. And here are some special magic. And then here is a backwards GRU layer. And at the end, we concatenate them together. We then meld them together. And basically, we produce a single output. Is this word NER or not? Now to train this, basically we get all the parameters. This single line works out the gradients of every input or every weight within this whole thing. And then this is a thing which updates the training function or updates every weight. So when you're doing this in, like in practical terms, everyone will be using a framework. And that framework will enable you to define how all of the weights, how all of the inputs relate to each other. But because the framework has complete knowledge of the functions which you're making, it can do differentiation all on its own. So you never have to actually explicitly differentiate anything. You just said, I want my updates to go in the direction of the differential, or there's even more fancy stuff that people do to make this stuff quicker. And eventually this is going to say define the RNA model, come on. So the aim of having this in a VirtualBox appliance is that people who are keen can actually delve into it. This is actually running on your laptop. And I kind of like, rather than just watch me, the fact that you could actually take this apart yourselves and play with it, I think is a win. Assuming it finishes. Come on. Now, at this point, one thing I should mention is TensorFlow. So the Theano, which I'm using here, is something produced by a group in Montreal and has been going for quite a while. Here we go, it's defined. And it's good code, well, it's Python. Okay. So in what I'm doing here now is some actual iterations. So it's actually training. So what they do for Theano is you define the various layers of your network and the calculations that need to be performed. And when you say run, Theano will spit out C code or C++ code or CUDA code, essentially by doing print statements. So this is kind of, it's insane that it works, but it does work. And for a long time, people have been hacking away at this thing. And it's amazing that it works. What has happened with Google, though, is they recognized a good thing. And they created a framework, partly using the same people that did Theano, and they wrote it in C++. And they actually used engineering principles. And that's much better. So even though Theano and TensorFlow are very, very rooted in the same kind of concepts, TensorFlow comes along and it's fast and it's bulletproof, and they've produced backends for lots of different things. It's not particularly efficient because Theano was developed in a time when people had much smaller GPUs and cared about every little cycle. The Google developer boxes have 128 gig RAM as minimum. So TensorFlow tends to be less careful with your memory. On the other hand, it's well done. So at the moment, I'm in between doing the Theano thing and moving over to TensorFlow, since I see that as being more of like an industry applicable thing. Even though understanding how TensorFlow works is 90% of the way there. People are going to want to learn. Understanding how Theano works gets you a huge distance. There's very little barrier to entry to doing it in TensorFlow instead. So this needs to get up to iteration 1,000. So it's getting there. And this is a kind of a typical neural network learning cycle. In that I've defined the inputs, I've defined some outputs, I've defined how to train this network to get closer and closer to these outputs, and it iterates slowly towards a network which is getting better. And you can see that the training loss, which started out as being 0.38, this is some measure of how well it's doing NER, is gradually decreasing and decreasing. This is gradient descent acting in our favor.
Why is it 1,000 times 1,000?
It's 1,000 times because that's as long as I can stand.
There's a times 1 in a
core. Oh, that's because if I'm running, so I was fortunate to have a Titan X, which will work and then I can use numbers other than 1,000. So this is another kind of factor in deep learning, is that most experiments last about 8 hours, mainly because that's as long as people can stand to wait. So if the experiment completes in 2 minutes, then you're not trying hard enough. If it takes 3 weeks, then you can't do enough in a year. So people tend to run it for as long as they can remain sane. One of the issues with doing it on the VirtualBox is I can't get to your GPU without huge amounts of trickery pokery. So there is a means that, so this whole thing is developed in the open. So this is a GitHub repo. There is a method for running this local, and there you can specify, yes, I want my GPU to be involved, and it will do the whole thing. This, I can be sure that everyone's got it set up in exactly the same way, and it runs in 244 seconds. So I don't really want to do that. Oh, good. Okay. So here is kind of the proof of the pudding. And unfortunately, it's in debug kind of mode. So here are some sentences. And each word is followed by, firstly, what NLTK thinks, and secondly, what the RNN thinks. So Dr. Andrews, 1-1, it's identified that as being a name, works at Red Cat Labs. It perfectly agrees with NLTK. So basically, this has worked. This is understood what NLTK thinks about every word here. Let's see what part of speech analysis and semantics looks like. That's all nothing. When are you off to New York, Chaitanya? Okay. So New York, NLTK has picked out as being New and York. The RNN failed to pick out New as being a special word here. Chaitanya is recognized as being a thing. But if we then go into the other mode, basically I've just lowercased everything. So Dr. Andrews, here you can see that the RNN doesn't actually care what case this is in. NLTK absolutely does. NLTK is zero everywhere. It does not know anything about NER, even though it's part of the library. Whereas Dr. Andrews has been picked out, Red Cat Labs has been picked out. So the RNN without case information understands about the English language in a pretty surprising way. So this is learnt. So the embedding, I cheated by having a known good embedding. On the other hand, the RNN has learned all of this stuff off Wikipedia as we sat here. The kind of a QED is that it actually works. The NLTK is hopeless for this case, whereas the neural network has learned to do something from NLTK data, which NLT can't do itself.
So. Excuse me, can I have a question?
Sure.
So the word embeddings are built on the lowercase corpus.
Yes. I'm not sure where I got the word embeddings ultimately. I think either I downloaded them direct from the Stanford site and just carved them up because I only wanted 100,000 words. You can play around with this, or there's nothing, nothing will be destroyed here. So
I think that it might be important because you map the words if you consider
right,
the case.
In particular, I think I must have done something with forcing all the cases low, otherwise New York, it would have York versus Little York, or New versus Little New. So let me, somewhere in here. Oh. Okay. Come on. Excuse me. Let's not do that. Let's do that. Let's not do that. Let's do. Okay. So basically, the picture which you saw the code for is this. You've got these input words. You've got a forward passing GRU. You've got a backward passing GRU. then these Ys correspond to, is this a name or not? So questions, we kind of had questions. Okay. So let's just go, this is very quickly, kind of in a wrap-up mode, more exotic. So we can see that sentences as input kind of works, in that we've actually had a concrete example of putting sentences in, getting answers, which indicate that it understood something about English. Can we output sentences as well? And what can we do? Where does that go? So one trick that people do is that they feed the outputs as if they were inputs. So every node chooses some output. You then choose an answer, and then you feed that answer as if that was new input. So here's an example. Now, the key thing is this is all differentiable. Since it's all differentiable, we can train it. So here, basically, we take an input of some kind. Say the word is the. We do this stuff and pick out the word which it's suggesting, and it may suggest the word cat. We then say, okay, let's, given that you said the, and my next word is cat, what do I say next? And I might say sat. And then you keep going, eating your own output, until you say stop. And then that is a way where you can actually start, or you can even start with just a fake hidden state. Produce me some text. And the neural network will just spit out words until it says stop. Each output being the next input. So I have that, there's a whole thing on here, there's no time. Basically, this allows you to do poetry. So this is feeding in the words of Shakespeare. First, it converts it to Perl. Then it starts to understand a bit about word letter frequencies. So this is another thing. It's just producing a letter at each time, and using what it just produced, produces the next letter and the next letter. So it's produced, it's read the poems of Shakespeare, I think, 100 times. It's not great. In 1,000, and it's begun to understand a bit more about Shakespeare. Well, understand. It's better at faking it, okay? Now if you choose a bigger network and give it the plays of Shakespeare, and this is producing one character at a time, it actually has, like, stage directions, and it's figured out how to do a whole bunch of stuff. So this is kind of cool. So this is output, just you train it on text, and every time it comes up with a letter, you say, no, the letter should have been this other letter, It gradually gets the idea that it should indent it properly. It's kind of interesting. But what can you do with this? Well, it's actually not just for Shakespeare is fun, but what you can do is, instead of starting it off with just a word of Shakespeare, you can start it off with a state here which you generate from an image. So what you can do is you can present it with an image of a cat sitting on a mat, and you just hope that it spews out the words, the cat is sitting on the mat. And you do this with lots and lots of images, and this is all differentiable, so it will learn it. So here's some image labeling, and this is what Google will do on your image. If you put in stuff, if you upload stuff in your photo folder, this is kind of, so this image is a person riding on a motorcycle on a dirt road. So this is produced entirely by the machine spewing words out at random, but guided by what the images it's seen. Or here's, so these were first ones are pretty good. There's some errors here. This is two dogs playing the grass. Now the thing is, this network has obviously made it's an offer by one error, right? So, but it has no concept of what really dogs are, or running on grasses, or playing, or anything like this. It's just spewed this out because this kind of thing is associated with this kind of picture. A skateboarder does a trick on a ramp, which isn't quite right. A red motorcycle parked on the side of the road. This is not a Redmond circle. So this is a very simple, this is exactly what this is a picture of that thing. It doesn't do anything other than units you've kind of seen, in that this is a whole bunch of matrix multiplies, a whole bunch of funky gate things, trained using gradient descent. And it seems to understand something. Another game you can play is called sequence to sequence. So basically you can take in some words, and we can use the end state of this to spew out other words. The reason you might want to do this is to translate between English and Chinese. And this is what Google is now doing for translation between all language pairs. So it used to be that people used to only want English to French, and you'd have to have huge corpuses from English to French. They've now designed this kind of interface in such a way that any language pairs will train all other language pairs. So if I have English to French, which is easy to find because of the Montreal Parliament, it will also help me translate English to Korean, given that I can translate Chinese to Korean and English to Chinese. All these pairs will now reinforce each other. So there's been a step change in how good this translation's got within the last year. There's even more crazy stuff. So this is kind of the maximal crazy that is worth diagramming. Basically, one problem these things have is if you've got a very long sentence, you do tend to forget the order of things. I mean, you can imagine a very nasty sentence which would say, I am my brother's mother's daughter's sister's who is, you know, whose cat is this? Okay, and it'd be very easy to get lost in this. So what people do is have something called an attention mechanism, whereby you have your original word, the original sentence, and it spews up kind of markers, which will be part of the hidden states. And it then gives the output thing the opportunity to look back at those markers and essentially figure out where it is in the sentence. But the key thing is these markers are produced by an algorithmic process which is differentiable. The looking back can be differentiated. Everything can be differentiated. So this thing all on its own will learn how to pay attention to the sentence. So if you can give it an English sentence and ask for the French output, it will. You can actually get diagrams of how it will jiggle around the words because it's shifting all the word order around. So you can actually see some of its kind of mental process. Anyway, questions? So this is home straight now.
Referring to so when you are doing a recognition for names, right? But then most of the time people don't always write down the names correctly. So for example, Martin Andrews may be written together. So are you able to find some similar representation to identify that this is a name actually?
Right, so one the corpus idea works really well for English names, because my name is probably in a 400,000, or the word Martin and Andrews is probably in a 400,000 word dictionary. Similarly with most Chinese names, because even though there's a huge variety of Chinese names, the individual words are not that unusual. But when you get to Indian, they seem to be accumulating huge names, and there's lots of unique names in Indian. So the problem is, I'm not that familiar with Indian names, but if I see an Indian name, it's clearly an Indian name, and it won't be in my dictionary. And if I'm doing this tokenization business of this embedding business, I will only have an unknown token associated with it, and so that's a problem. So the next step in this is to kind of go deeper, which is let's read every character of this separately and then learn the LSTM of all the characters and then get it to learn implicitly the embedding, so it won't understand the words from an external embedding, it will just learn from the whole of Wikipedia what every chain of characters means. And then you would store it, then you would have a chance of saying, okay, I've found an Indian name. I've so the next, doing it one level deeper on a character basis is kind of where people are heading now. But you know, then you're heading towards, it's not so much you can piece the pieces together, because the embedding is kind of a nice component. You're training a lot across a big corpus. So, I long to try that, but anyway.
Model encounters an invalid sentence. Is there another hypothesis that you can reject?
Okay, so the problem with this kind of training is that you only train it on valid stuff. And it would be, wouldn't it be nice to have a flag which says invalid input, basically. And it will never actually see any invalid input. So this is another kind of big open question, in that there's all this image stuff which will train on 1,000 different image classes, but none of it will say this is a bad image or these are alternative facts. You know, it's just it's a problem. And so also it's a very domain specific thing, so that if you trained it on news or Wikipedia and you start feeding it tweets, it's going to have a very, very hard time. So, or movie reviews, or
if data becomes big, how does the model scale? Does that complexity and the two things, which is the size and also the computational time?
Well, the size is basically dictated by how much resources you give it to begin with. It's not as if it will auto scale to be bigger because you gave it a more difficult task. It will just perform less well. Now, the surprising thing about this little NER task is that just using two units works fine. It's crazy that it works so well. So in some ways, just trying it and seeing whether you get any kind of results with a very minimum model is a very valid first step. But by the time you get up to translating multi-language, it's going to need big capacity. So, but. Okay, let me conclude, and I'll be around or whatever. And sorry, there is a whole deep learning workshop. This is my repo. So there's a whole bunch of all the code in here. We'll actually create a VirtualBox appliance for you if you wanted to. But it's also basically, it allows you to work on a local basis. This stuff, deep learning, you can apply to NLP. It's not such an easy fit as images. It's still in its early stage, in that people are trying crazy stuff just to see what will work. Please contact me if you have feedback. I should point out there is a new TensorFlow group. Sorry, with apologies to the PyData group. So this is its very first meeting is in the middle of February. It's sponsored by Google. It's going to be all TensorFlow. So, if you love this stuff and you have got your feet wet with TensorFlow, excellent. Come along to that, because that's good. It's, on the other hand, it won't be as diverse as all of this stuff is with Theano. It's not going to be about Theano and NLTK and stuff. It's going to be TensorFlow, because otherwise we won't get pizza. Hiring. So I would love to hire someone full-time to do commercial NLP and some kind of intern person for more kind of prototyping and demos. But that's, just contact me via email, very casual. The end. Thank you. Oh, and...
One question, two questions. Comments? Okay. So, okay, for those of you who have asked a question, we can actually take away one of these. So just feel free to pick them up. And we haven't asked the question, then still find them over here. Okay. And yeah, thanks again. Thanks a lot. And let's hear for Dr. Martin again. We will be opening.